Hello all, I welcome you to this part 2 of this lecture series about the response spectrum analysis procedure. In this part, I will discuss the mathematical formulation of the elastic response spectrum analysis procedure for multiple degree of freedom systems. So let's continue. So you might already know that the response spectrum analysis is based on the idea of vibration modes of the structure. And one of the earliest developments in classical modal analysis were done by Arturo Danuso, who bring the idea of mode shapes and modal analysis from acoustics into the earthquake engineering and the response of structures against earthquakes. The earliest use of the response spectrum analysis can be traced to a Belgian-American aeronautical engineer by the name Maurice Biot in 1932. He used this method in his PhD thesis under the supervision of Theodor von Karman, who himself was a noted mathematician. At that time, this method was called the spectral method of structural analysis. But now it's called the elastic response spectrum analysis procedure. So let's quickly review its mathematical formulation. I will use a four-story building, this one, to explain this procedure. It is a shear building subjected to a ground motion ug, which is a function of time, and it has only 4 degrees of freedom, one at each story level. So u1, u2, u3 and u4 are the 4 degrees of freedom, and this structure is subjected to a ground displacement ug, which is also a function of time. So ug is the ground displacement, but u will be the structural displacement, and that will be relative to the ground. So the actual deflection of the structure will be denoted by u. So if we write u total vector, that will be equal to the ground displacement, which will be added to the displacement of each story, this one. And I can write this vector u total as the sum of ground displacement vector and the structural displacement vector. And I can also write it as a vector containing all values as 1, means one vector, and multiplied by ug plus the structural displacement vector, this one. So please note down that for vectors I am using this double line here, but for scalars I am using this single line for u. So why I have written this ug vector in this form? Because sometimes there can be some degrees of freedom in the structure which are not in lateral direction as u1, u2, u3 and u4. For example, if there is a vertical degree of freedom in the structure, and that will not be affected by the lateral ground shaking. So the entry in this vector corresponding to that particular degree of freedom can be made equal to 0, and that's how we can make sure that that particular degree of freedom is not affected by the lateral ground shaking. So, but in this case, since all the 4 degrees of freedom in our structure are in the direction of the applied ground shaking, so that's why all 4 entries will be 1. So the u total vector will be equal to 1 vector into ug plus u vector of the structure. And if we take double derivative, we will get that u double dot total, which is the total acceleration, is equal to 1 vector multiplied by ground acceleration plus structural acceleration vector. So if we write the governing equation of motion for a multiple degree of freedom system subjected to the ground motion, that will be this first equation, this one. And we know that the u dot vector, which is the structural velocity vector, and u vector, that is the structural displacement vector, in these vectors the ground displacement is not added, or ground velocity is not added, but in the acceleration vector there will be a u total vector, which is the sum of ground acceleration and structural acceleration, because inertial forces depends on the absolute values of acceleration, but the development of damping forces and development of elastic restoring forces, they depend on only the structural velocity and structural displacement respectively. So that's why we will have this u dot dot total vector here, but we will not have the u dot total or u total vector here. So now u dot dot total vector we already know, so we can put it in here, and we can take this term on the right hand side, and we will have this term on the right hand side now. So now this is the structural acceleration, structural velocity, structural displacement, but we have a term which is a function of ground acceleration on the right hand side now. So now we will use the idea of classical modal analysis, which is that we will transform this equation of motion, which is the coupled equation of motion and cannot be solved one by one. For example, we have 4 degrees of freedom in our structure. So this equation is basically 4 equations. But these 4 equations cannot be solved one by one because they are coupled. So they have to be solved simultaneously. But we know that already from classical modal analysis that if we transform this u coordinates into new coordinates, let's say we call them q coordinates, and those q coordinates are called the modal coordinates, and in that transformation from u vector to a new q vector, and both will be the function of time obviously, if we use the phi matrix, which is the mode shape matrix, as the transformation matrix between them, then the new equation which we will get in q coordinates after putting this equation into our governing equation, the new equation in q coordinates will be uncoupled. So in that q coordinates we can solve each equation of each mode one by one, and there is no need to solve them simultaneously. So this is here we have written the u vector as sum of all the phi I into qi. Basically we have transformed the u vector into a new q vector, which is also a function of time, and use the mode shape matrix as the transformation matrix. And mode shape matrix is a matrix containing all the 4 mode shapes. So it's a scalar matrix. In this case, phi matrix is equal to first mode shape values, second mode shape values, and third mode shape values, and fourth mode shape values. This will be the total phi matrix in our 4-story shear building case. So since we have 4 degrees of freedom and we have 4 stories, so this phi matrix will be a 4x4 matrix. Each column of this matrix will be one mode shape. So first mode shape, this one, second mode shape, third mode shape, and fourth mode shape. This q vector, new coordinates, will be a new vector containing 4 entries, q1, q2, q3, and q4. All 4 of them, just like u of t, are the function of time. So this is the basic idea, this is the underlying idea, which is called the modal expansion of displacement vector. So we have expanded the displacement vector into the contributions from vibration modes into some new coordinates, which are q coordinates in this case. And we know that if we apply this idea of modal expansion of displacement vector, we will get the governing equation of motion in an uncoupled form, and in that form we can solve that equation for each mode separately. And that we will see here, that for example here was u dot dot of t vector. So I have replaced it with phi matrix into q dot dot of t vector. Similarly here there was u dot of t vector. So I have replaced it with phi matrix into q dot of t vector. Here also there was u vector. So I have replaced it with phi into q vector. So if we multiply the phi transpose matrix with this whole equation, we will get this equation, this one, phi transpose m into phi into q dot dot vector plus phi transpose c matrix, which is the damping matrix, into phi into q dot vector plus phi transpose into k into phi into q vector is equal to minus phi transpose into m into one vector into the ground acceleration function, this one. So we can apply the modal orthogonality now, and we have already know what is the modal orthogonality. We know that the phi matrix multiplied by mass matrix into phi matrix again, phi matrix transpose into mass matrix into phi matrix again. If we do that, modal orthogonality says that we will get a diagonal matrix, and each entry of that diagonal matrix will be the modal mass. For example, modal mass of the first mode, modal mass of the second mode, modal mass of the third mode and fourth mode, for example, and all the off diagonal terms will be zero. And this is the idea, or this is the property of mode shapes, which helps in uncoupling the equations of motion, that all the off diagonal terms become zero and we are left with only the diagonal entries. This is the property of modal orthogonality. Similarly, if we assume the classical damping, in that case the mode shape vectors will also be orthogonal to each other with respect to C matrix. So what does this mean? That if we have phi matrix transpose into C matrix into phi matrix again, we will again have the diagonal matrix, and each entry will be equal to 2 xi modal mass into omega for each mode, and all the off diagonal terms will be zero. And similarly, we also know from modal orthogonality that phi matrix transpose into K matrix into phi matrix again, that is also a diagonal matrix, and each term is the modal stiffness in this case, and all the off diagonal terms will be zero. So let's apply this modal orthogonality in this case, because we have made the form of our governing equation of motion such that we can apply this modal orthogonality. We have made this phi transpose into M into phi here, phi transpose into C into phi here, and phi transpose into K into phi here. So now we can apply the modal orthogonality. This multiplication of three matrices will be a matrix with only diagonal entries, and each entry will be the modal mass. So let's denote the modal mass as this mu symbol. So mu 1, mu 2, mu 3 and mu 4, because there are four modes in this structure, 4 degrees of freedom. So this will be a 4 by 4 matrix with all off diagonal terms equal to 0. Multiply by the q dot dot vector, which is the acceleration vector, but you cannot call it the acceleration of the structure now. The actual acceleration of the structure is u dot dot of t. Q dot dot of t is the transformed form in modal coordinates or normal coordinates. Similarly, here you have phi transpose into C into phi matrix. You can write it as a diagonal matrix with each entry equal to this, and all the off diagonal terms will be zero. Here also the modal orthogonality will be applied, so phi transpose into K into phi matrix. This will result in another matrix with all the off diagonal terms equal to zero, and the diagonal terms will be the modal stiffness, and that modal stiffness we already know from classical modal analysis, it is modal mass into omega square of that mode multiplied by q of t is equal to, let's call this multiplication phi transpose matrix into mass matrix into one vector, let's call it as L vector, because obviously phi transpose will be in this case 4 by 4 or degree of freedom by degree of freedom, mass matrix will also be 4 by 4, but this one vector is 4 by 1. So the multiplication of these three things will result in a 4 by 1 vector, and let's call that vector as L vector, and it has four entries. Each entry of that vector can be calculated using this expression, that you multiply a specific mode shape transpose into mass matrix into one, you will get that particular entry of the L vector. So if you want to get all four values of this L vector, you have to multiply this modal matrix, multiply by mass matrix, which will be diagonal for lumped mass case, and one vector, which is this one. In summation form, you can write this L vector entries like this, that you multiply the mass of a jth story with the ordinate of an ith mode at jth story, and you sum them all for all stories j equal to 1 to 4, and then you will get the particular entry of that L vector. So you can write this equation in both forms, in matrix form also, as well as in summation form. So now we know that because of these off diagonal terms being zero in all of these three terms, now this equation of motion in q coordinates is uncoupled. Because if we write the, let's say, first equation, which will be the first row of this matrix multiplied by q dot dot of t plus first row of this matrix multiplied by q dot of t plus first row of this matrix into q of t is equal to the first entry of L vector multiplied by ug dot dot of t function. So that first equation which we will get will only involve the properties from first mode shape. It will not involve the properties from second mode shape or second story, for example. So it will be an uncoupled equation which can be solved independently. And for any ith mode shape, we can write that modal equation as this one, that modal mass of that mode shape multiplied by qi dot dot. And now qi dot dot is not a vector, it's a particular entry, ith entry of the q dot dot vector, plus 2 xi mu omega into qi dot plus mu omega I square qi is equal to minus li ug dot dot. So this is the uncoupled equation of motion for an ith mode, and it is uncoupled, which means it can be independently solved and there is no need to solve the complete matrix equation simultaneously. So for example, if you want mu I for a particular ith mode, you only need that mode because you already know that mu is the diagonal entry of this matrix capital phi, which is the modal matrix multiplied by mass matrix multiplied by phi matrix again, and here we have transpose also. So the diagonal entry of the resulting matrix is the mu value. So for any ith mode, you don't need to have this whole phi matrix, all the modes. You only need that particular ith mode because only that particular entry in the diagonal matrix is required. So you can just multiply the ith mode shape transpose with mass matrix into again that ith mode shape. So now this phi I is not this capital phi matrix, it's just one mode shape, it's just one column of that phi matrix. So it's the ith column of the phi matrix transpose multiplied by the mass matrix multiplied by the same ith column. So it will become this one, that transpose of the ith column will be a row vector, and this is the first mode shape, for example, or second mode shape or third mode shape. So the I denotes the number of mode shape and the other number denotes the number of story. So it's the value of the mode shape at that particular story. So it's the ith column transpose which becomes the row vector in this case, multiply by the mass matrix multiply by the again ith column or ith mode shape, you will get the mu I value. And in summation form you can write it like this, because here we have phi I4 multiplied by m4 and again multiplied by phi I4. So here you have mj into phi ij square, because it is multiplied two times, and we have summation of all of this for j equal to 1 to 4, and j is the number of story, so j is the story and I is the mode. So for any ith mode, you can calculate the modal mass using this equation. So you already know this modal mass if you know the mode shape. Similarly, you might also know the modal damping of that particular mode, modal mass already known, modal frequency already known from classical modal analysis. And the only thing you further require is this Li, which is the entry in the L vector corresponding to the ith mode shape. So if you are writing this equation for first mode, Li will be the first entry, for example. And that Li can be determined using last slide here. You know already that Li is equal to phi I transpose into m into one vector, or in summation form you can write it like this. So you already know for any ith mode all the properties required to solve this modal equation. So if you want to solve it for first mode, you don't require anything from second mode shape. You only require first mode phi 1, you require mass matrix, and that's all you require to solve it for first mode. One more simplification we can do here is that we can divide this whole equation, this one, top one, with mu I, and we will get this simplified form of this first equation. This one we can write it as qi dot dot plus 2 xi I omega I qi dot plus omega I square q is equal to minus gamma I into ug dot dot vector, where gamma I is the ratio between li and mu I. So it can be written as this ratio. This top entry is basically li, the ith entry of the L vector li, and this bottom entry is this mu I. So this ratio will be a scalar number for a particular ith mode, because this is one scalar number ith entry, and this is another scalar number which is the diagonal entry in the phi transpose into M into phi matrix multiplication. So now this gamma I is a new scalar number which will be multiplied with ug dot dot. So this whole thing is a time function now, because gamma I is a scalar number for a particular ith mode. So this gamma I is also known as the modal participation factor, and it tells us how a particular ith mode responds to the ground vibration. Its name, modal participation factor, sometimes gives the impression that this factor might tell you that how much a particular mode will contribute in the total dynamic response of the structure. But in fact, this number is not the only number which decides how much a particular mode will contribute towards the total dynamic response. There are a lot of other factors also which affects the contribution of a particular mode in the total dynamic response. So although this number affects the response contribution from a particular vibration mode, but there are other factors also. So now we have defined this new modal participation factor, which is gamma I, and that is equal to Li over mu I, and this is the equation for that. It will be a scalar number for a particular mode. So this number is multiplied here. So now we have to solve this equation of motion for ith mode. We have to solve it for all vibration modes. And the normal procedure for classical modal analysis is that we solve each equation of motion in q coordinates, and we calculate the q vector, and then we multiply this q vector with the same transformation matrix, which is the mode shape matrix, and we take the solution back to u coordinates, and u coordinate solution is the one which is required, which has the physical meaning, and these are the story displacements for our structure. But we also have another option instead of doing this here. So now we have two options. We already got the uncoupled equation of motion for each mode. The first default option is that we solve the uncoupled equations of motion for each significant mode, and that equation is represented by a single degree of freedom system. Obviously, if you see one modal equation, one equation which was q dot dot of t plus 2 xi omega q dot of t plus omega square, for ith mode it will be i here also, into q of t is equal to minus gamma I into ug dot dot function of time. So if you see this equation, this is the equation of a single degree of freedom system, with natural frequency equal to omega I, and the displacement of that single degree of freedom system is represented as q of t, and this single degree of freedom system has a damping equal to xi I. So each modal equation can be seen as the equation of a single degree of freedom system. So it means that the total multiple degree of freedom system can be seen as a sum of several single degree of freedom systems, each governed by its modal equation. So the first option was that we solve these uncoupled equation of motion for each significantly contributing mode represented by a single degree of freedom like this, and sum the dynamic responses to get the dynamic response of multiple degree of freedom system. And that, as I have explained in last slide, that you calculate the q vector in these coordinates, you multiply with the phi matrix again to get the u vector, and u vector is the final solution. So you transform back this q coordinate solution into u coordinate solution. If you do that, the analysis procedure will be called as the elastic modal response history analysis procedure, and that is available in several structural analysis software also. The other option we have, and we will use this option in this case, and that is the response spectrum analysis procedure. That instead of solving the governing equation of motion for each mode against a particular ground motion, why not we invoke the idea of elastic response spectrum? So for example, if we have the elastic response spectrum of the same earthquake, this one for example is the response spectrum. We have spectral acceleration on y-axis and the time period on the x-axis, and we can also have the spectral displacement on y-axis and time period on x-axis, just like this one. So what we can do is, we can directly pick the peak response of each significant mode represented by a single degree of freedom system, because we already have the omega I for each mode that can be converted to time period for that particular mode, and that time period can be used to directly pick the spectral ordinate, for example spectral displacement for a particular mode shape TI, and for that particular TI we can also pick the spectral acceleration. For example, we can also pick the spectral displacement, this one and this one. And then for example, if we are talking about displacement response, we can pick the spectral displacement and then approximately combine those peak responses to get the peak response of the multiple degree of freedom system. For example, we have four modes in this structure, so we can pick the spectral displacement for all those four modes like this, and we can approximately combine them. We cannot directly sum them because these are already the peak values of displacement for each mode, and these peaks may not occur at the same time, so we cannot directly add them. We have to statistically combine them, for example using SRSS or CQC methods, as we will see in next slides. So this is one option for us now at this stage, where we have the uncoupled equation of motion. So instead of solving them using, for example, step by step direct integration method or by any other method, we directly pick the peak response here using the elastic response spectrum of that particular earthquake at that particular damping. So this response spectrum should be of the same UG dot dot for which we are solving this multiple degree of freedom system, and that response spectrum should be for the damping equal to xi I, the same damping which is the damping of that particular mode. If the damping for each mode is same, let's say 5%, so that particular response spectrum should be corresponding to the damping ratio of 5%. So this is our second option, and if we use that option, we call this procedure as the response spectrum analysis procedure. And obviously this procedure converts a dynamic problem into a static problem using the idea of response spectrum. So instead of solving the governing equation of motion in time domain, we will directly pick the peak values from response spectrum and statistically combine them to get the total response of multiple degree of freedom system. So response spectrum analysis will give us only peak response, but the elastic modal response history analysis is a dynamic analysis procedure, so it will give us the total history of response. So it will give us total history of response. So it's a dynamic analysis procedure. So here we will use the idea of elastic response spectrum, and we will call it the response spectrum analysis procedure. We already have for any ith mode the uncoupled equation of motion, as we have seen in last slides. What we can do is, we can directly pick the peak value of qi, the ith mode entry of the q vector, as the same gamma I multiplied by the spectral displacement of that mode corresponding to the period of that mode. So basically, if we have the ug dot dot function, we convert it into the response spectrum, spectral displacement versus time period, at the same damping ratio which is required for that particular mode, and we pick the spectral displacement value, that value corresponding to the time period of that particular mode. So this is Ti and this is SDI. But since the equation has this gamma multiplier here, you should note that the conversion of this UG dot dot of T into the spectrum corresponds to this equation, U dot dot of T plus 2 xi omega m U dot of T plus m omega square, sorry, there will be no m here and there will be no m here also, omega square into U of T is equal to minus UG dot dot function of time. So the response spectrum construction corresponds to this equation. Here we have a gamma multiplier which is not present here. There is no gamma here. So that's why we have to multiply this gamma with the spectral displacement so that we can get the Q answer, which is the modal coordinate for displacement in this case. So the ith entry of Q vector should be equal to the multiplication of this gamma factor, because this gamma is multiplied with the ground acceleration vector. So that should also be multiplied with the response, because this is the elastic analysis. So the response coming from the response spectrum should be multiplied with this gamma number so that you get the ith entry of the Q vector. So this way we can directly pick the maximum number of the Qi. And if we were using the modal response history analysis, we would have got the complete history of this Qi. So Qi would have been the function of time in that particular case. But now we directly know the peak number, maybe this one. This is the Qi max, and that is directly available from the response spectrum of that earthquake ground motion. So now we convert back from Q coordinates, we multiply it with the modal matrix to go to U coordinates. So we have to multiply with the ith mode shape here to get the ith mode contribution in the U coordinates. So for example, when we multiply this gamma I into SDI with the first mode shape, we get a new vector which can be called as the first mode's contribution towards this total U vector. So this U vector is the total vector. It's the combined from all modes. It's a combined displacement vector for all modes. So this is for all modes. But here if we multiply only with first mode, we will get the contribution of first mode towards this total U vector. So this is a total U vector, but it itself is comprised of the contributions from several modes, and the ith mode will have this much contribution. So this is very important point to understand, that this transformation equation is ideally written for the time domain analysis, which is the modal response history analysis. Here we have this Q of T vector with all the entries as function of time. But now we will get from response spectrum analysis a Q of T vector which will not be having the entries as time functions, but it will have the peak numbers only. So it's a static vector now, Q1 max, Q2 max, similarly Q3 and Q4 max. You will have this vector from response spectrum analysis. So it will not be a function of time, just like in elastic modal response history analysis. So this is the reason we cannot simply use the same transformation equation, because in that transformation, all the modal contributions Q1, Q2, Q3 and Q4, they will be added when we multiply it in the matrix form. And we cannot add it, we already know that since the Qi max for each mode is not occurring at the same time, we cannot simply add them as the use of this transformation equation will do. So what we have to do is that we have to multiply each mode separately to get the contribution of that particular mode towards this total vector U. So this Ui vector, basically originally it is made up of the contributions from different modes, but those modes were automatically added if we use this transformation equation in the matrix form. But here we have to separately calculate the contributions of each mode and then combine them approximately to get this total U vector. So instead of this complete transformation, we will have just one column of this modal matrix. For example, the ith column representing the ith mode shape here. So you multiply that ith column only to get the contribution of that particular mode towards the U vector. You will not multiply the total phi matrix directly to the peak numbers, because in that case they will be directly added as the matrix multiplication will happen. So instead of doing that, you will have just ith column separate out from that modal matrix. You multiply that and then you get a part of U vector which corresponds to the ith mode contribution in that U vector. So this SDI is determined from the elastic response spectrum at Ti and Xi I. So this was about the contribution of an ith mode towards displacement. In case of interstory drift ratio, which is the displacement at upper story minus the displacement at lower story, you can write that in this form, because for a particular mode gamma I and SDI are constants. So only thing which will be changing for each story is the mode shape ordinates. So that's why you have the upper ordinate minus the lower story ordinate, and that's how you can get the contribution of a particular mode towards the interstory drift ratio. So this is the IDR for a particular mode I, and obviously these will be the maximum values because the response spectrum is plotted for maximum response values. Here J is the story number, so it's the story number or floor number. So phi at J minus phi at J minus 1 for a particular ith mode. So this was about the displacement and interstory drift responses for a particular ith mode. But what about forces? The equivalent static forces corresponding to the ith mode, that is the forces which will deform the structure in Ui max shape and magnitude, those forces will be Fsi vector is equal to K matrix into Ui max. So if you multiply the ith mode contribution of displacement with the K matrix, you will get a vector of static forces, which are the forces which when applied statically, they will produce the same displacement as the contribution of ith mode shape towards the displacement. So that's how we convert the ith mode's contribution in displacement into an equivalent forces. So this is the equivalent static force vector. This is also a vector. So it's a force pattern, basically a vector. And if it is applied statically to the structure, it will produce the same displacements, which are the contribution of first mode shape or second mode shape or any ith mode shape in the total displacement vector. So we can further simplify this equation as Ui max can be written as gamma I into phi I into SDI, and K matrix is the same. And since from the eigenvalue analysis we already know this eigen equation, that K into phi is equal to omega I square into m into phi. So you can replace this K into phi with omega I square into m into phi. And now you can see here that this omega square into SDI is basically the spectral acceleration SAI. So the relationship between spectral displacement and spectral acceleration, we already know from the elastic response spectrum case that spectral acceleration is equal to omega square into spectral displacement. So if we have spectral displacement, we can convert it into spectral acceleration and vice versa. So we can write finally the equivalent static force vector for any ith mode, this one, is equal to the gamma I, modal participation factor of that mode, multiplied by the mass matrix, multiplied by the phi vector, the mode shape, that ith mode shape vector, multiplied by the spectral acceleration of that vector. So this is the force vector corresponding to an ith mode. If a particular building has, let's say, four modes, as we are seeing here in this example, then we can calculate these four force vectors, and then we can apply them to the same structure, and the result will be the same displacement, which will be the contribution of that particular mode in the total U vector. because we have calculated these force vectors from that same equation F is equal to Ku, and we set the u as the contribution of a particular mode shape in u vector. So the idea is now that if we have a multiple degree of freedom system, we calculate the F vectors, equivalent static force vectors, for all the significant vibration modes, and we apply them. For example, for first mode shape, the force vector will look like first mode shape because all of these entries are constant. So for a particular mode, ith mode, these entries, spectral acceleration, mass matrix, and the modal participation factor of that mode, for a particular ith mode, these numbers will be constant. So only thing which will be varying from story to story is the mode shape. So it means that the shape of this force vector when applied at each story will be exactly same as the shape of the mode shape. So for first mode shape, the force vector should look like this, just like the first mode shape. The second force vector for the second mode should look like exactly the second mode shape. So some of the forces will be leftward, some will be rightward, just like this. The third mode shape vector should exactly look like the third mode, which is the some of the forces will be in this direction, some will be in the other direction, and then again will be in the other direction. The amplitude of the force vector will be proportional to the amplitude of the mode shape. So for example, in first mode, the maximum number will be at the top and it will keep on reducing as we go towards bottom. But for second mode shape, the maximum number may be at any other place other than top. It can be at a height of 2/3 of the total height of the building, or it can be at any other location. So the effective earthquake forces, or the equivalent static forces, for each mode will exactly look like that mode shape, because they will deform that structure into that mode shape deformation pattern to get all the responses which are the contributions of that particular mode shape. So for example, if I apply the first mode shape pattern, this is F vector 1, this is F vector 2, this is let's say F vector 3, and we can have other F vectors also. So for example, if I apply this F vector 1 to my building statically and perform the static structural analysis, F is equal to Ku, whatever story shear, story moments, displacement, interstory drift ratios, axial strains, whatever responses I will get, those responses will be only the contribution of first mode shape towards my total responses. So all the responses, let's say if I call any response quantity as R1 in this case, that is coming from applying the first mode's equivalent static force, let's call that particular response maybe shear in a particular beam or a moment in a particular column, for example, let's call it R1. And let's say the same response when we apply the second equivalent static force vector corresponding to mode shape 2, let's call it R2, and then R3 for example from third mode shape vector. We have to statistically combine them to get the total R, which is the total response from all mode shapes. So the most common combination rule is the SRSS, which is the square root of the sum of squares, SRSS, which simply says that you square the response for all modes, you sum them, and then you take their under root, square root, to get a normalized or resultant value for that particular response. Since all of the R1, R2 and R3 were not occurring at the same time, so we cannot directly add them. We cannot have the absolute summation. That will be a very wrong kind of combination. So we just normalize them using SRSS and get the resultant value. So the ETABS by default report only this R value, which is the total response combined from all modes for any particular component. So in later part of this video, we will see that how we can individually get R1 or R2 or R3 or the response against any ith mode from ETABS directly. So these are some of the modal combination rules. SRSS is the most common one, that you square a particular R, which is the response quantity from any ith mode, you square them and then sum them and then take the under root. Another model combination rule can be absolute sum, that you directly sum them, and obviously that will give you a very conservative total response. So it is only the upper bound and too conservative, and it is not popular. So there is another more advanced combination rule, and that is the complete quadratic combination CQC, and I will not discuss the details of this combination rule. Basically it is more accurate than SRSS as shown by the research, and you can apply this combination rule for the structures which have very closely spaced natural frequencies, and the E-tabs provide you the facility to select any of the modal combination rule while defining the response spectrum analysis load case. So the summary is, I will quickly go through this and then I will go to E-tabs, that you determine the M and K matrix and the Xi I for each mode, and then you perform the eigenvalue analysis, the modal analysis, basically modal analysis, to calculate the time periods for each mode and the mode shapes, so that you can have the phi vectors, and then you can also have the time periods to go to the spectrum and pick the spectral displacement or spectral acceleration values. So then you compute the peak modal responses of each significant mode for each ith mode. So for Ti and Xi I, you pick the spectral acceleration and spectral displacement from the spectrum, which can be the spectrum for the applied earthquake, or it can also be the smooth spectrum for the purpose of design provided by different building codes. Then you compute story displacements and the interstory drift ratios using these two expressions, and then you compute the equivalent static forces using this expression for each particular mode, ith mode, as I have shown in the last slide. Then you compute all the responses by static analysis of the structure under this force vectors. So that is the reason that I call this response spectrum analysis as the static analysis procedure, although some people call it the dynamic analysis procedure, or at least pseudo dynamic analysis procedure, because ultimately you are applying the FSI vectors statically to your building. But this is also true that FSI is coming from the theory of structural dynamics and some dynamic characteristics of the building, for example time periods and mode shapes of the building. So maybe we can call it a pseudo dynamic analysis procedure. The dynamic analog of that method would be the modal response history analysis procedure. And then the final step, which is to estimate the peak response by combining the peaks of all individual modal responses. So usually lower modes contribute significantly to overall response, so maybe only first few modes can be included in the analysis. So for example, if you have a 50 story building, you may not need to add the modal responses of all 50 modes of that building. You may just simply add the first 4 or 5 modes, and the building codes also have a guideline about that you should include those number of modes in the analysis, which gives you at least 90% of the cumulative modal mass participation. So RSA reduces the dynamic problem into a static problem, in fact a series of static analysis under each equivalent earthquake force vector, equivalent static force vector, for some few modes which you will select in the software. RSA still retains the feature of dynamic analysis because it is based on the idea of mode shapes, modal analysis, natural time periods, natural frequencies, and modal damping ratios. The dynamic part of the problem is kind of already done while developing the spectra. So since you are directly using the spectrum of an earthquake to pick the values at time periods, so you can say that the dynamic analysis already done, and we are directly provided with the peak values. So it's a kind of an analysis procedure which is somewhere in between dynamic analysis and static analysis. From the application point of view, to calculate the response of each mode, it is a static analysis. But that equivalent static forces which we apply for each mode comes from the theory of structural dynamics. So one more important consideration, which is the comparison between a response spectrum analysis and the modal response history analysis. The UI max, which we will get from response spectrum analysis using this equation, will be same as the peak displacements from response history analysis, because the spectra is already based on the response history analysis. Since we have picked this value from the spectrum of that same earthquake which you would have used in the response history analysis also. So you will get the total history of the response, let's say displacement response, but in RSA you will get the peak number only. But that peak number will exactly match with the peak number obtained from the response history analysis. But this will be true only for each mode separately. When we combine the modal responses using the modal combination rule, then the peak displacement extracted from the response history analysis results will not match with the peak values obtained from the response spectrum analysis results. Because in response history analysis, you are directly transforming the Q vector, which is the function of time, multiplying it with the phi matrix to get the U vector. So basically you are directly adding the response histories when we multiply this matrix with the vector. So you are directly adding, but we are not directly adding the modal responses here. We are combining them statistically using maybe SRSS. So therefore these two total displacements U max combined from all modes will not match with the total displacement of all modes obtained from the modal response history analysis results. One more thing which you might have considered here is that the direction of equivalent static force vectors is controlled by the algebraic sign of the mode shapes. So that you already have seen that the direction of forces is proportional to the mode shape. So whatever the shape of mode is, the forces will follow the same direction. One very important point here is that in RSA, calculating one response from combined peak value of other response is wrong. So it's not that you can calculate the peak displacements first, let's say U max combined from all modes, UI max, sum of UI max or SRSS of UI max, and then you use this U max to calculate the maximum value of interstory drift ratio. This will be a wrong practice. You have to do it at each mode level for the UI max, and then you have to SRSS those interstory drifts for each mode to get the maximum interstory drift ratio. So for example, IDR max at any floor is not equal to the U max of upper floor and U max of lower floor, where U max is calculated already combined value of all the modes. This will be a wrong practice. The right practice to do is that you calculate the IDR value for each mode separately. So you convert each UI max separately to IDR for that particular mode, and then you SRSS them to get the total IDR value. Similarly, the story shear at any floor cannot be calculated directly by summing all the applied equivalent forces for all modes. Obviously, we know that, for example, for first mode shape, if we have this equivalent static forces, the story shear will be like this. So these are the numbers of story shear. So it's not that you directly, for example, if you have several equivalent static forces, so you directly add them to get the total story shear. You have to calculate the story shear for each mode, and then you have to SRSS the story shears for each mode to get the combined story shear for all modes. So this is an important consideration which you should consider. You should not make this mistake while calculating the total responses. Each response should be calculated at an individual mode level and then needs to be SRSS. You cannot use a particular combined response to calculate another combined response. You have to calculate each response at each individual mode level and then combine. So this is the summary in graphical form, that you have a structure, you apply the eigenvalue analysis or modal analysis to calculate T1, T2, T3. So each modal equation will look like as though it is a separate single degree of freedom system, and then you pick the spectral acceleration values or spectral displacement values for U, and then you calculate the effective static forces for each mode, and then you apply them separately to your structure to get any particular response, and then at the end you combine these responses by SRSS or CQC, and different building codes also prescribed a reduction factor to reduce these responses to account for the inelasticity or ductility effects that we will discuss later. So how we use the response spectra, that we calculate the time period for each mode, and for that particular time period and the specified damping ratio, we pick the spectral acceleration from the response spectrum. And we can also have the response spectrum corresponding to velocity and displacement, and then the equivalent static force vectors are applied and all the responses are calculated, and at the end you use a modal combination rule to sum those responses. So one last thing before I go to ETABS, let's quickly compare equivalent lateral force procedure and this response spectrum analysis procedure. The static method specified in building codes, which are basically the equivalent lateral force procedures, they are based on single mode response and appropriate for simple and regular structures. So for example, all those methods which directly provide you a formula for base shear, for example, which look like this, and it recommends that you distribute that base shear along the story height and you apply that force to account for the seismic effects, that kind of methods are based on only the single mode response, because you only have just one equivalent static force vector and all the seismic responses are the result of the application of this vector only. But the dynamic analysis should be used for complex buildings to determine significant response characteristics. So the effect of structure's dynamic characteristics on vertical distribution of lateral forces should be considered. The increase in dynamic loads due to torsional moments should be considered. And the influence of higher modes resulting in an increase in story shear and deformations should be considered. So at the elastic structural level, the response spectrum analysis is supposed to account for these effects, which the ELF procedure doesn't account. So for complex buildings, it is recommended that at least you should apply the response spectrum analysis so that any higher mode effects, if they are significantly contributing the dynamic response of the building, should be considered in the analysis of the building. So I will end this session here and I will see you in the third part of this video lecture series. In that part, we will discuss about the code-based response spectrum analysis procedure as prescribed in the Uniform Building Code 1997. So I will see you there. Till then, stay safe and thank you for your attention.